This here was the last rated EF5 tornado, the highest possible tornado rating. It may surprise you that this tornado was over 11 years ago. We are currently in the longest drought of seeing a tornado rated a 5 on the tornado rating system, the enhanced Fujita scale.
Why is that?
It has been a hot topic of debate amongst the weather community for years now. As the drought continues to increase in length, the theories seem to get crazier and crazier. To get to the bottom of this, I decided to dive into the theories of why this drought exists. There are a number of potential explanations for this complex controversy, but I figured I'd start with the simplest. There have been no tornadoes of EF5 intensity. If you've paid any attention to the news around weather, then you know this is simply not the case. Strong to violent tornadoes happen every year in the States, with some years having more than others. For a tornado to be classified as violent, i.e. a tornado that earns a 4 or 5 on the rating scale, is already extremely rare. Earns being the key word in that last sentence. To really dig into this further, however, we have to get an understanding of how tornadoes are rated. Granted, this is the key source for where the controversy begins. Here's a history lesson. The Fujita scale is the brainchild of Dr. Tetsuya Fujita, created in the early 1970s. After decades of researching tornadoes, one of nature's most elusive phenomena, his main tool to study them was through the damage that they had left behind. He found that most tornadoes were brief and weak, causing little damage, while others would carve miles upon miles of damage that would be beyond human comprehension. His 6-point scale, F0 through 5, would allow for the classification of these tornadoes in the most consistent fashion possible at the time. His scale would become the cornerstone of tornado classification after the 1974 super outbreak, where its use would cement itself not only in the meteorological community, but with the greater public as well. Over the following years, the National Weather Service meteorologists refined their systematic practice of retracing the paths left behind by tornadoes, finding instances of damage, and then ranking them on Fujita's scale. However, it quickly became clear that there was an issue. Fujita's original scale was rather broad with its descriptions for each category, which made its interpretation rather subjective from surveyor to surveyor. To address this, the meteorological, engineering, and research worlds came together to revise Fujita's scale. In early 2007, the new and improved Enhanced Fujita, or EF scale, was put into service by the National Weather Service. This new version introduced 28 categories to assign each damage indicator, with varying degrees of damage within each category. Now, damage indicators can be systematically assigned to the new adjusted 0 through 5 scale. In theory, the subjectivity was mostly eliminated. However, a fundamental flaw still remained. Damage is not a direct measurement of a tornado's wind speed. By 2007, a handful of tornadoes had been sampled by mobile Doppler radar, a tool Dr. Fujita could have only dreamed of back in the 1970s. While damage was still the most consistent metric across all tornado paths, this revolutionary tool was rapidly improving and would be the most direct method yet to use in the classification process.
At least one would think.
Eventually, cracks began to show within this new scale. It didn't take long for discrepancies between radar measurements and the final classification on the EF scale were occurring. In 2009, a tornado in Wyoming had wind speeds measured of 271 miles per hour by mobile radar, only a couple dozen feet off of the ground, technically meaning it surpassed the EF5 threshold of 201 miles per hour. However, the ground survey only yielded a rating of EF2, or a max estimated speed of 135 miles per hour. This discrepancy issue would all come to a head in May of 2013, when the record-breaking El Reno tornado would tear across central Oklahoma. Mobile radar confirmed a peak wind speed of 291 miles per hour within the lowest 10 meters of the tornado, firmly placing it in the EF5 threshold. The National Weather Service office in Norman, Oklahoma, would rate the tornado as such. Until August, when a statement would come in from the office stating, quote, "Despite the radar-measured wind speeds, the survey team did not find damage that would support a rating higher than EF3. While the wind measurements from the mobile radars are considered reliable, NWS policy for determining EF ratings is based on surveys of ground damage.
El Reno was downgraded from an EF5 to an EF3. The precedence was set. Damage will be the only contributing factor for a tornado's rating.
Coincidentally, 11 days prior was the tornado we mentioned at the beginning, the Moore, Oklahoma EF5. Circling back around to the original EF5 drought explanation theory, we can now really see that this is not the case. But this goes beyond just including new tools in the rating process. The proven method, in theory, was even having its own issues. Several high-end EF4 tornadoes in the wake of Moore have had instances of damage that have been argued as EF5 caliber based on the precedent set with prior EF5 rated tornadoes. Some of the main tornadoes people in the weather community point to are Valonia in 2014, Rochelle in 2015, Mayfield in 2021, and Rolling Fork in 2023. In the Valonia EF4, for example, a well-constructed family residence earned an EF4 190 mile per hour rating. Despite maxing out the degree of damage for that indicator, its cited reason for not earning an EF5 rating was due to, quote, "Ratings are not normally assigned based on only one structure. The house was hit by debris from downtown buildings, so there was uncertainty as to how much damage was done by the tornado itself versus flying debris. And some trees, tall and skinny, were still standing along a ditch about 100 yards away. That's three separate reasons given. The EF scale training calls for confirming a damage indicator's degree of damage with contextuals around the structure. So if a house is completely swept away, but an adjacent tree survived with branches intact, then it nullifies that damage indicator. Additionally, if a damage indicator is subjected to collateral damage, like significant wind-driven debris, then of course the degree of damage will be increased, but not at the will of the tornado's pure wind speed.
Okay, fair, that all seems to make sense.
However, if we rewind to the prior year in Moore, Oklahoma, the EF5 damage indicators were all in an extremely densely populated area where hundreds of homes were impacted. Thus, wouldn't all of these be subjected to collateral windborne debris damage? Both the Valonia and Moore damage indicators have a heavily stripped hardwood tree present, so at least that's consistent. But there are those aforementioned smaller trees still standing 100 yards away in the Valonia damage indicator. Back in Moore, there were wooden telephone poles only leaning just 80 yards from the row of four EF5 damage indicators, which would have technically limited these indicators from earning an EF5 given the reasoning in Valonia. Note that these poles were photographed aerially the day following the tornado, not the replacement poles shown in the Damage Assessment Toolkit image. And finally, if one damage indicator isn't enough to classify a tornado as an EF5, then technically that would rule out the Piedmont, Oklahoma EF5 in 2011, as it only has one non-standard indicator assigning it an EF5 rating. All of this cross-examination is to say that where the EF scale attempted to limit subjectivity, it ultimately just made it more granular, detail-oriented, and make it vary from an office-to-office basis within the National Weather Service. To further complicate things, the Piedmont EF5 in 2011 had exceptions made in order to grant its EF5 status, which ultimately opened the door for all sorts of speculation for tornadoes down the line. If we compile all of the reasons and precedents set with the controversial high-end EF4 ratings, you can look back at every single EF5 and use those reasons to nullify every single one of their ratings, with the exception of one. Parkersburg in 2008 seems to be the most bulletproof case that would maintain its EF5 based on the additional precedents set after 2013. But nonetheless, since we know for a fact we've observed multiple EF5 capable tornadoes in recent years, is there a greater motive as to why all of these reasonings have been purposely used in order to withhold an EF5 rating for 11 years? Some of the arguments as to why an EF5 rating would be intentionally withheld downright get conspiratorial. The most frequent being is what I like to call the insurance agenda. If you look on Twitter, Reddit, or even in the comment sections of my past videos, there are multiple claims that the NWS withholds EF5 ratings because they are tied to the puppet strings of the insurance companies, who will do anything to pay out as little as possible to their affected policyholders. Digging into this particularly evil claim, it is quickly very clear that insurance payouts have nothing to do with what a tornado was assigned. If your home was completely slabbed in a high-end EF4 or an EF5, your home is still completely gone, no matter the rating. In fact, it's often seen that what would be considered high-end EF3 damage is enough to deem a property a total loss in the eyes of insurance appraisers. The damage has been done, it's an act of God that no human could have prevented. Another adjacent claim is that EF5 ratings are withheld in order to prevent FEMA resources from being utilized in tornado-affected areas. Once again, a little bit of digging quickly disproves that as well. FEMA's resources are not at all dependent on what the rating of a tornado is. Just this past week, for example, FEMA resources were utilized in Palm Beach, Florida, where an EF3 tornado tore through a heavily populated area.
With monetary motives ruled out, could there be another motive behind this? Some would suggest that it could be chalked up to a Great Plains bias.
It's no secret that Oklahoma is the center of the severe meteorology world, but does that really warrant a bias towards rating tornadoes? There have been a total of 9 tornadoes rated a 5 since the adoption of the EF scale. 5 of them occurred in what is considered traditional Tornado Alley, while the other 4 were in what is deemed Dixie Alley. These 4, however, were a part of the super outbreak of 2011. An extreme outlier event that only compares to the 1974 super outbreak. The Deep South is home to extremely violent, long-track tornadoes in the early spring, many of which have been debated as EF5-capable tornadoes. Most often, though, construction standards severely lack in this part of the country, as mobile homes, which are notoriously weak in tornadoes, are often the main damage indicator type. Even with the lacking best-practice construction, tornadoes like Rolling Fork in 2023 were extremely close to breaking the EF5 threshold. It earned a 195 mph rating, which naturally led to questions asked of what separates this high-end EF4 from an EF5 when it's only a 6 mph gap. At the end of the day, there is no statistically backed evidence of a bias when all violent tornadoes are counted in the EF scale era between these two regions. So what does this leave for reasons behind the EF5 drought? There really is no direct answer for this, but instead a culmination of factors. Firstly, as the use of the EF scale has progressed, the understanding of how structures behave in tornadoes has as well. The most common construction practices are weaker than estimated and do not withstand the brute force of even a high-end EF4 tornado. This has led to a decline in the percentage of tornadoes that have earned a violent tornado rating over the EF scale era. Over that same span, the compounding effects of precedents set by reasons EF4s did not achieve EF5 status have created an even tighter criteria for any damage indicator to have any consideration for an EF5 rating. Keep in mind, the 2013 Moore EF5 had over 4,000 recorded indicators, of which only 9 earned EF5 status. What was once rare has become impossible to achieve with human-made structures, thus leading to the final point. The EF scale, while well-intentioned, its implementation and execution were ultimately doomed from the start. Yes, damage is still the most consistent metric across the board when it comes to rating tornadoes, but how does the NWS not adapt to use the best tools at its disposal for rating tornadoes? At the time of the EF scale's adoption, mobile radars were proven, getting better, and ultimately becoming more abundant. While impossible to have for every tornado, its accuracy is beyond any damage indicator that could ever be provided. You don't have to take my word for it. The EF scale authors said it themselves. Quote, "The technology of portable Doppler radar should also be a part of the EF scale process, either as a direct measurement when available or as a means of validating the wind speeds estimated by the experts. Additional refinements will be possible as experience is gained from the use of the EF scale. Over the course of 17 years, these opportunities to further iterate on this version of the scale have not happened.
Why? I do not know with certainty, but my theory is that it was simply just not high on the priority list.
With the National Weather Service being a government entity, change and adaptation is not something that occurs overnight. With extremely dated IT infrastructure, the constant need for improved forecasting, and the hefty day-to-day responsibilities, revisions to the EF scale are simply low on the priority list. The amount of experts involved across multiple institutions and agencies who all have their own day-to-day responsibilities has made it difficult for this issue to be addressed.
However, there is good news.
There is a new scale on the way. Presentations at meteorological conferences have revealed not only new damage indicator types, but also the inclusion of wind measurements into the rating process. It is a breath of fresh air for those who have longed for a revamped scale. But ultimately, while the whole weather community wants the best possible result out of a rating system, at the end of the day, arguing over a tornado rating is just simply insensitive. The fact a tornado has earned an EF4 or 5 rating means it undoubtedly has created the worst day for dozens, hundreds, or even thousands of lives. Family homes are effectively erased from existence, oftentimes with loved ones with them. For those that survive, an EF4 or EF5 rating does not bring back their home, their possessions, or their loved ones. I don't know when the next EF5 will be, but one thing is for certain. It will be a catastrophe nobody wants to see.